I then request Dr. Peush Sahni. He's a teacher of all editors, and he's quite active in teaching research ethics and publication ethics. So I request to...
Thank you for asking me to be here. I unfortunately have PowerPoints. I don't know whether I have any points or not. Most of the points are points that have already been talked about. At various fora, at various journals, in various books, in various regulatory agencies' documents. So what I'm going to say is not original. And I'm going to move away from something that both Dr. Patwardhan and Dr. Lagotia has alluded to, and that's predatory publishing, predatory journals, what are also called pseudo-journals. Because publication ethics is a whole large ballgame which is far beyond just this issue which has come up in the last 10 years or so. Dr. Lagotia has already mentioned, he's alluded to the fact that why this whole issue has come up, and there are still problems in trying to sort it out for a lot of us. So I hope during the course of the next 2 days, this will get dealt with a little more. But what I'm going to try and do is to talk to you about three major international organizations and say what they've been doing as far as publication ethics is concerned. Okay, I can go wherever you want me to be. All right, is that okay? All right, so if I can, the next slide, please. Does it work? It doesn't seem to work. No? Doesn't work. Yeah, it works. Okay. So look through this. We have an interactive session. I'm not going to talk. You're going to talk. Look at this. Do you think there is something amiss here? So there is a senior clinician who's requested to write a chapter for a new book. He's written an original article on the subject recently. And therefore, since the book and the article are totally different formats, different audiences, he decides to go ahead and use text, tables, diagrams from his published paper in his chapter. What do you think? He's allowed to do it, he should do it, he shouldn't do it. Come along, people. It's early in the morning, we can't be tired and fatigued. Our brains have to start working. You had all had breakfast in the morning? Yeah, okay, good. So what do you think? Good, bad, ugly? Make a choice. It may be right, it may be wrong, doesn't matter. My decisions, my choices are 3/4 of the time wrong. Even as a clinician, I tell my patients, you've come to me, you get treated by me, you're making your choices, those may be wrong choices. I can't assure you of results. I can tell you what is possible with what I offer, but it may not be possible to achieve those results in all patients. So if you work in the clinical field, you know that. That's truth. You can run away from it. If you're a clinician, you can practice and you can tell people, I guarantee those results. Those results that happen, happen because they happen, not because of you. They happen despite you. So let's make a decision. Are we okay with this? Are we not okay with this? All those who are okay with it?
Not okay.
Not okay. How many people not okay with it? Okay, those who are not okay with it, why are you not okay with it? It's my work. I'm not copying somebody's idea. So it's my work. If I will not publish or repeat what I have said, so you think Newton and Einstein wrote it or said it once and that was it? They stopped saying it? No. They wrote one chapter after another chapter after a third chapter after a fourth chapter after a fifth chapter after a sixth paper after a seventh paper, and they kept doing it. the next paper that they wrote built up on their previous idea. So what's wrong with it? There's something wrong with it. I agree with you that it's wrong, but what is wrong? That's not what is wrong. This is not. So it's my book. I have used it. Why is it wrong? Can I make it right if it's wrong? So disclosure, transparency. The key thing in publication is transparency. If I've done this before, I should tell people I've done it before. If I haven't done it, somebody else has done it, but I tweaked that idea to find something more, I need to tell people that somebody else did it, I just tweaked it. The problem is, I want to take the full credit. I don't want to stop there. Why should I be the one who just tweaked the idea? The idea was mine, and that's where the problems start. Okay, so behavior are actions that do not conform to ethical standards in two places, conducting research or publishing research comprise what is called scientific misconduct. So publication ethics is focused on publishing research, but there is scientific misconduct which encompasses something more than just publication ethics. So does it occur? Some of these sound familiar, names, places, people. So immunologist decided that he wanted to get another grant, extension of his grant. Whatever work he had done hadn't succeeded, had a photograph of a white mouse. Was doing an experiment to transplant skin from a black mouse onto a white mouse. Hadn't succeeded. So decided to paint a black patch on that photograph to say he had succeeded and therefore give him an extension of his grant. There are other stories too related to that. Discovery of streptomycin won the Nobel Prize. The student accused the guide that it was the student's work, not the guide's work. And the guide got the Nobel Prize, not the student. People who work in clinical medicine would have heard of this gentleman because he was editor-in-chief of a major textbook of medicine. And with him worked a gentleman who, if you go and search on PubMed, has possibly the largest number of retractions of work ever published. And his co-author is a gentleman who's extremely respected. David Baltimore was a Nobel laureate. He was president of the Rockefeller Foundation. Didn't do much. All that happened was that there was a clinician, there was a laboratory person who, a whistleblower, who accused somebody working in one of his laboratories of scientific misconduct. What happened to David Baltimore? He had to step down from the presidency of the Rockefeller Foundation. There's a paper on breast cancer that got presented at the American Society of Clinical Oncology meeting. It's a very major meeting where oncologists from all over the world come and present path-breaking work. This path-breaking work suggested bone marrow transplants was the answer for women with breast cancer who had metastatic bone disease. Something that would be difficult to understand how that could happen and how that could be useful. But that paper got presented, and women in the United, the press picked it up, the media picked it up, as it picks up everything today and blows it out of proportion. So it picked it up in those days, blew it up out of proportion, and there was a strong lobby then and today in the United States of women with breast cancer. Some of the first ladies had breast cancer. So they lobbied for women with metastatic bone disease from breast cancer to receive bone marrow transplants. Insurance companies and medical advisors of insurance companies said there's something wrong here. And they started investigating this. And what did they find? Single researcher, 7 patients instead of 75, results nowhere near what were claimed. In fact, there was no response at all. So it does occur, all these things in various facets, falsification, fabrication, plagiarism, everything happens. So I dread taking this slide to an audience which is full of anesthetists. Three anesthetists, never did studies on pain medication, over 100 papers, all now retracted. On colloid research, 89 of his 102 studies fraudulent. 212 of 249 papers investigated work on postoperative nausea and vomiting. Over 150 papers had fabricated data. How did this come about? Six editors of anesthesia journals got together and said, there is something wrong with these guys' papers. And they got together and started investigating this and found this. Now, a lot of us often say, so in India, why should we say everything is happening, that's happening is bad outside? It happens in India as well. And this is in 1992, the British Medical Journal published a paper, and they then published this account, an expression of concern about the validity of this paper. In fact, the Lancet went on in 2002 to go ahead and question the vast majority of work of this gentleman who used to work, I think still works in the city of Moradabad in UP. And they said that there was doubt about the work that this person had done, but they were never able to establish conclusively, couldn't get evidence that there was something amiss with his work. So people say, publish or perish. So if you don't publish, you'll perish. That was the American philosophy. So if you wanted to progress in your careers, you had to publish. But when you publish 80 papers which are fabricated, 240 papers that are fabricated, then obviously it's not publish or perish. It's just greed. You've been getting away with it. Once you get away with the first murder, you decide you will go ahead and murder somebody else again. So that's what happens. So the reason I'm talking about all this is that there are this variety of scientific misconduct, publication misconduct that happens all the time. Dr. Sanjay Pai tomorrow is going to talk to you about falsification, fabrication, and plagiarism. I'm not going to touch upon those issues at all. But these are serious issues of scientific misconduct, in addition to the issue of predatory publishing and predatory journals or pseudo-journals. So as scientists, as researchers, we need to be aware of not only what is going wrong when we send our work for publication, but what we may do wrong. So we need to be right ourselves when we start doing our research. There are other practices, of course, that I am not going to talk about. So I was asked to talk about COPE, WAME, and ICMJE initiatives. So first and foremost, how many of you have heard of these organizations? COPE, WAME, or ICMJE? So if you've heard of one of them, just raise your hands. Okay? If you've heard of two of them, raise your hands. If you've heard of three of them, raise your hands. Okay, so very few. So the next few slides are going to talk about what are these organizations and what do they do. So the Committee on Publication Ethics actually started off as a very small group of editors of two journals. It wasn't called the Committee on Publication Ethics, the British Medical Journal and Lancet. Both editors knew each other, they worked in the same city of London. And they decided to talk to each other about what was happening in their journals. And that's how the whole story started off. Today, it's an organization which has over 5,000 or 7,000 journals as members. And what it does is it looks at publication ethics. So it's called Committee on Publication Ethics, and the acronym is COPE. And that's their website. Their tagline is promoting integrity in research and its publication. And what are their focus areas? Their focus areas are these. They call these core practices. They look at allegations of misconduct, look at issues of authorship and contributorship, complaints and appeals by people. So you could complain against a journal editor who was a member of COPE. That's the only policing system we have for journal editors. Otherwise, they are holier than thou. You can't go and touch an editor and tell him, you haven't published my paper and hope to get published the next time around. You may be able to do it if you go through COPE. You might just be able to. Conflicts of interest. They talk about data and reproducibility. They talk about ethical oversight, intellectual property, how journals should be managed, peer review processes, and post-publication discussions and corrections. So if you really look at it, they talk about almost everything under the sun as far as publication ethics are concerned. So if you have something that concerns you related to publication ethics, you're worried about it, this is the place to go and look up. They have some flow charts. I have a PDF file which I can put up just now, but I'm going to avoid doing that. Essentially, it tells people who get involved in or see something happening which they feel is incorrect and they wish to tackle it as to how they should go about tackling this. These flow charts were prepared primarily for editors of journals to tackle allegations of misconduct, of issues of authorship, issues of duplicate publication, issues of conflicts of interest. I think there are now 18 flowcharts. I've stopped counting them. There were 14 at one point in time. I think there are 18 now. They've increased the number of, they've incorporated Biomed Central. Today morning I was looking at them and they've incorporated recently one from the Biomed Central publishers group, a chart into their flow chart. So essentially, if you think that you are seeing misconduct of any form, it's a good place to go to. Go to the COPE website, look up the flow charts, and then go through them and see what should be the right course of action for you as a researcher, because that's the course of action an editor is going to take. So maybe you could follow some of those steps before you reach the editor. The second organization, WAME, W-A-M-E, is called the World Association of Medical Editors, and it's just like any other professional society. It's a global non-profit voluntary association of editors of peer-reviewed medical journals. And this is from their recently launched website, something that has been in the making for close to 2 years. And they have a professionalism code of conduct for all of their members. So all these organizations essentially are espousing people who are their members. So COPE has members and asks its members to follow certain practices and guidelines. And WAME has members, and these members are again people who are either medical journal editors, editors of peer-reviewed medical journals, or they're people who are interested in the process of peer review and medical publishing, who are called scholar members. And they ask them that medical editors should pursue lifelong learning and teaching, both formal and informal, and recognize the need to remedy knowledge deficits in themselves and their co-editors. So they're focused on editors and trying to improve publication practices of editors. You'd say, editors are always holier than thou. They're the great people. They're the people who do all the things that are right. No, unfortunately not. They're all humans. If researchers can go wrong, authors can go wrong, if reviewers can go wrong, where do the editors come from? Authors, researchers, reviewers, so they too could go wrong. So what does the World Association of Medical Editors do? It develops policies for medical journal editors, and some of these policies relate to and are useful for authors and researchers. The most important of these is the principles of transparency and best practice in scholarly publishing. And probably this is what the organizers wanted me to talk about in great length and depth in this talk over 45 minutes. But I chose to ignore it because things have evolved and moved ahead from these principles. There have been two revisions of it. But essentially what this was in response to a paper published in the journal Science in 2013. Have you heard of this paper? Have you heard of a person called John Bohannon? No. Okay, so John Bohannon published, he was a reporter with the journal Science, and what he did was he sent out flawed papers to over 150 journals. Papers which were obviously flawed, papers which nobody should have published. He picked out these journals from a list which was prepared by a gentleman called Jeffrey Beale. Heard of Jeffrey Beale? No? No. Okay, so Jeffrey Beale was a librarian whom researchers used to go to, in contrast to a lot of librarians in India. I'm sorry, there are librarians in the room, and I mean no disrespect to any of them, but there are exceptions in every field. But the vast majority of librarians in India, whether in schools or in colleges or in medical institutions, are happy to sit behind a desk and ensure that there are books and journals for people to read and do nothing more than that. That's the fact. This gentleman used to do more than that, and that's what most librarians do, and a lot of people in this room would also do. They help researchers research journals. They help researchers by telling them where they can get resources to try and answer their curiosity. So he used to help people do this, and he started coming across requests for papers from journals which he'd not heard of, which when he started looking at were journals which he thought were dubious. And he started from there and started building up a list of these predatory or pseudo journals. And it was from this list that John Bohannon had chosen the journals to whom he sent the flawed papers. He expected everybody would reject these papers. In fact, that didn't happen. A large number of journals accepted those papers, and some actually published those flawed papers, those obviously flawed papers. Some of these journals which published these flawed papers were open access journals, and therefore open access publishing got equated with, open access publishing is equal to predatory publishing, and open access journals got a bad name. Because of this, four organizations prepared these principles of transparency and best practices in scholarly publishing. These four organizations were COPE, whom I've mentioned, WAME, whom I'm talking about, and two other organizations, one known as the Directory of Open Access Journals, and the other OASPA, Organization of Open Access Scholarly Publishing or Scholarly Publishers Association. Forget the acronym exactly. But these four organizations got together and prepared these principles, essentially trying to educate authors and researchers as to where to go and publish and what were the red flags to look for when you went to a new journal to publish which you hadn't heard of. What should you start looking for to find out whether this journal is genuine or not genuine? All open access journals are not necessarily predatory journals. In fact, some of the world's best open access, best journals are open access journals. The PLOS group of journals, Public Library of Science, acronym PLOS, all the PLOS group of journals are high quality journals. They all follow the open access model. They all ask you to pay for publishing. I would go ahead, Dr. Lakhotia said he won't go and pay and publish. I'd be more than happy to pay and publish in PLOS if I can get there. Sorry? So that's a different matter. My institution gives me some money occasionally, not all the time, but occasionally. But if I could get a paper into PLOS, I'd be happy. Just as I would be happy to get a paper into Lancet or into Science or into Nature. But there are good open access journals. So open access journal is not equivalent to predatory publishing. So what WAME therefore does is prepare policies for medical editors, but these are very useful for authors as well. And amongst some of the interesting policies it has for authors is policies related to authorship. Something that you and I are in desperate need of in this country. An issue that we don't like to talk about are authorship issues. In this country, I think publication ethics, the biggest issue in publication ethics is authorship. Next comes predatory and pseudo-publishing, because I call heads of departments, I'm head of department. I used to say this before I became a head of department. I promised myself I'll continue to say this after I become a head of department. Therefore, I've continued to say this in all public fora. Most heads of departments in India in science, especially in medical, in the health sciences, are the Gabbar Singhs of Indian science. They force their students to behave in a particular manner. You're not allowed to ask a question. You put my name on the paper. I'll be the first author. You've done no work. I've done all the work, and so on and so forth. And this is something that's a big, big issue in our country. It's been there for a long, long time, much before predatory publishing came into being. It also has something called ethics case discussions and ethics consultations, something very similar to what COPE does. But while COPE does it for its member journals, WAME does it for anybody and everybody. The only difference is COPE can police its members. It can tell its members, behave, otherwise we will take away your membership. WAME doesn't do that because there are people who are not WAME members who can still whose issues can still be discussed anonymously and opinions given on them. So if you get into a difficulty on a publication ethics related issue, this is a place to go to and look up. Finally comes the International Committee of Medical Journal Editors. Now COPE is 5,000, WAME is 1,800, the International Committee of Medical Journal Editors is 16 people. But they're more influential today, unfortunately or fortunately, than either COPE or WAME. And they do a lot of work. What they have is something called a set of recommendations for the conduct, reporting, editing, and publication of scholarly work in medical journals. And their major initiative started off from the time they actually came into being. And they came into being in response to not a researcher, not an editor, but the secretary of a professor whose articles used to get rejected frequently, complaining to the professor that she had to retype his papers again and again because his friends who were editors of journals had different ways in which they wanted articles submitted to them. And I'm talking of the time when we didn't have electronic typewriters, computers, but only manual typewriters, and somebody had to publish, retype a manuscript 20 pages long, 30 pages long, not once, but six times, because it had got rejected five times. And so this professor decided offhandedly, like all absent-minded professors, to tell the secretary, write the letter, I'll sign it. She wrote the letter, addressed to the top five general medical journals. So this is the International Committee of Medical Journal Editors. COPE encompasses all science, WAME medical editors, and this is again only very focused medical editors. And she wrote to the top five general medical journal editors, the Lancet, the BMJ, the Annals of Internal Medicine, the New England Journal of Medicine, and the Journal of the American Medical Association. And these journal editors said, she's saying sense. Let's get together. So they got together in the city of Vancouver and then used to be called the Vancouver Group. They evolved from being a self-styled committee to something better than that today. But what they've done is they started producing what is called the uniform requirements for manuscripts submitted to biomedical journals, also called the uniform requirements, the URMs, or the Vancouver style, but today called the ICMJE recommendations. When in 2013, they changed the name, and every year they bring out annual revisions. What do they imply? They're just instructions to authors on how to prepare manuscripts and how to remain out of trouble. They also do a lot of other things. Where do you get them? You get them at their website called www.icmje.org. And the purpose was to review best practices and ethical standards. So ethics in publication is what they do or focus on. They define the roles of authors and contributors. They talk about author responsibilities. They talk about responsibilities in the submission and peer review process. They talk about journal owners and editorial freedom. I don't know how many of you are aware of the fact that the editor of the Journal of the American Medical Association was dismissed overnight. Why? By the American Medical Association. Interestingly, that is the time when Bill Clinton was being impeached for supposedly having oral sex with an intern. And the Journal of the American Medical Association published an article on a questionnaire, a survey of people as to whether they considered oral sex to be sex. And therefore, the American Medical Association, which is a very powerful body, decided to fire the editor of the Journal of the American Medical Association. And there came these journal owners and editorial freedom. So editors should be free from all these coercions, and that's what the ICMJE believes in. They also talk about a number of other issues here, and I won't go through all of these, but most important is scientific misconduct, expressions of concern, and retraction of publications. But in September of 2004, they made a discovery for themselves. They discovered how powerful they were. They got together, sat in a room, and decided that clinical trials should get registered. And why should this be done? Because there was growing evidence of the fact that researchers were corrupting science. They were corrupting publication record by being offered and accepting inducements to try and get trials done and results to be published of drug trials, of medical device trials, in a certain manner so that they were in favor of that drug or that trial. And they got together and said clinical trial registration, an attempt at making the process of trials transparent, needs to be done prior to publication. Sorry, prior to starting the research itself. And they said that a minimum registration data set needs to be put in to a public repository where this information should be available for posterity, so that if and when a person goes and looks up a trial, a published trial, he or she should be able to go back and look at a record as to what the researchers actually intended to do. So the defined primary outcome was what was the published primary outcome, not a minor secondary outcome which was shown to be the primary outcome. And that is how people were going ahead and manipulating science. They initially said 20 items, now they've gone ahead to say 24 items. But they emphasize on something which Dr. Lakhotia mentioned: trust, honesty, and transparency. So if you're honest, if you're transparent, and if the public, the general public, not us physicians, researchers, authors, editors, some holier than thou, but if the general public has trust in us, then we are doing fine. And that's the attempt that they made by instituting this mechanism of getting trials registered. It's become a huge movement. And every trial today, whether in India or abroad, needs to be registered. If a trial is not registered, a good journal will not publish it. If a good journal doesn't publish it, a pharmaceutical company which hopes to benefit from that trial, an individual researcher who hopes to benefit from that trial will not be able to benefit from it. And possibly the public who could benefit from it can also not benefit from it. It then, in August of 2007, emphasized on sponsorship, authorship, and accountability, an issue that one of their past editors, Marcia Angels, has written a book about. And she was the editor of the New England Journal of Medicine, and she emphasized that sponsorship of various kinds for trials by the pharmaceutical industry was again something that was corrupting science. As far as authorship was concerned, they emphasized that everybody who was an author needed to take public responsibility to be able to defend a paper. So if your head of department, if your senior colleague has no idea of how the research was done, you're the only one who knows what was done, then how is he or she going to defend the paper? Either for content or for its data or for its interpretation. So if you have somebody who is a co-author, he or she should be able to take public responsibility and defend the paper in public. They listed out authorship criteria as substantial contributions to conception and design, or acquisition of data, or analysis and interpretation of data. Drafting the article or revising it critically, not making two or three language changes, phrase changes, for important intellectual content, final approval of the version to be published, and to take responsibility for any errors and omissions. Paper published, 8 authors very happy. There were actually 2 genuine authors, 6 authors had nothing to do with it. Paper found to be fraudulent. The 6 authors are the first ones who run away and say, I had nothing to do with it. Why are you authors on the paper? If you are an author on your paper, you can't shirk your responsibility for errors and omissions. It is your responsibility if there is an error or an omission on that paper. At the National Medical Journal of India, from a very prestigious institution in this country, we received a paper many years ago written by 2 authors. One was the head of the institution and one was a junior researcher. It was a review paper. We sent it off for review. In those days, we didn't have emails, so we sent it off as snail mails. This is the 2nd or the 3rd year of publication. We are now into our 31st year of publication, so it's long back. The paper was sent off in a small, thin envelope. What came back was a thick, fat envelope. We opened the envelope and dropped out of that were photocopies of papers of the reviewer with paragraph after paragraph highlighted. So this gentleman had plagiarized work of this person. We wrote to the senior author. I was a junior flunky in the journal at that time. So I know the story because I was doing the errand boy work. Go get to the library, find this out, do this, whatever. So I knew exactly what had been picked up from where. So a letter was written to the senior author asking for an explanation, and the senior author calls back the editor and says, I had nothing to do with this paper. This is a junior fellow. But you signed on it. The forwarding letter is signed by you. How can you not take responsibility? Can't do it. Bad luck. So our journal has a policy of any author conducting or being found to be involved in publication or scientific misconduct, 3 years, no publications. We will not accept any papers for peer review. So don't submit to us. From that individual and from that department. Now, a lot of people have criticized us for this policy and said, why not the department? Why are you punishing the department? Everybody needs to know that somebody is being punished in that department. If you make it out in the public, then there's a hue and cry, there's a court case, there's all kinds of things, there are RTIs that you need to handle. And authors need to meet all these 4 conditions. Ghost authors, big problem. And gift authors, I've already said. So neither gift nor accept gifts of authorship. Other gifts are up to you. They then went on to bring out a paper on conflicts of interest or competing interests, and I have a talk later on, so I won't talk too much about this. So in a sense, these 3 organizations, I think, have done path-breaking work as far as raising awareness of publication ethics and issues around publication ethics are concerned. There are multiple issues, there are multiple players. So they're not just authors, editors, peer reviewers, everybody involved in the publication process and the research process could have an issue which could lead to misconduct. It's important to be aware. We can all be tempted. Patli gali se nikal jate hain, jaldi se aasan se kaam ho jayega. Please don't do that. Let's take a shortcut. Doesn't matter. Takes 2 years for your papers to be published, much better, rather than get published in 48 hours. Editors tend to be more proactive. There are editors of journals who have known to have published their whole correspondence with authors who were trying to defend work that they had not done. So the editor said, okay, you don't listen to us. We think your work is false. You don't agree with us. We'll just publish the correspondence in our journal. So they just published. So effectively, those researchers have mud on their face. But as authors, as researchers, we have access to multiple sources. Use them. Ask people who are more knowledgeable than you and try and get more information. So I hope I've given you some a sense of the gamut of problems of publication ethics and where you can go and find answers to them. I haven't provided you answers. I didn't intend to. It's very easy to provide answers. If you go look for answers yourself, you will remember those answers for the rest of your life. If I teach you answers here, you probably forget them the moment you walk out of this room. Thank you very much.